Next up, we've got a pair of pastoral Pokemon. Roselia is tiny in stature and didn't really stand out to fans when it first debuted, but that changed when it grew in height and donned a mask in the following generation upon becoming Roserade. As far as memories of Roserade goes, Cynthia had one, so must be pretty good, right? Since we're more interested in the competitive scene. So, how good were Roselia and Roserade actually? And in this video, we'll be talking about these competitive formats. Roselia was completely forgettable in its debut generation. It's slow, weak, frail, and other than a good base 100 special attack, all its stats were pretty miserable, with incredibly low HP and defense to go alongside meager special defense and speed. Thanks to these thoroughly mediocre stats, it never stood a chance in the land of Tyranitar, being unable to take on anything outside of a mono water Suicune, which of course would be done better by the excellent Celebi or the underrated Venusaur, who also came with the side benefits of being good against other Pokemon. It doesn't even have a role in the incredibly benevolent land of Events Underuse, where all sorts of awful Pokemon find some sort of role, and this is considering the fact that it learns the incredibly coveted Spikes. It just didn't have what it took to cut it. However, in Neverused, the power level was finally such to where it could exist effectively. It could check dangerous Pokemon such as Huntail and Hitmonchan, albeit barely and requiring caution, and help its teammates out with Spikes. It wasn't a superstar, but it was able to find a nice role within this metagame at least. Now on to DPP, Roselia evolved into Roserade, and upon evolving, Roserade got a much needed boost. While its defense remained miserable, and its newfound HP stat wasn't amazing, it was still quite the upgrade, and its special attack, special defense, and speed were now excellent, to the point where it could truly be usable. Although it was first known for absolutely excelling in underuse, it was eventually used so much in overuse that it moved up, and thus will focus on its career there. It wasn't exactly discovered or anything, it's just that its usage went up over time, since before it had always been used in the OU tier and known to be good, but not used to the level of being OU, although this was not a knock against it in any way, as made evident by how it eventually rose through the ranks. In the early days of Diamond and Pearl, it used the brunt of its great new 100 base speed alongside the new item Focus Sash to lay down another unique weapon which was also just introduced, the dangerous Toxic Spikes, and thus became the face of many offensive teams, although some stalled teams throughout the generation would also make use of its talents, especially Sleep Powder, since that can be huge. As a matter of fact, Roserade's influence on the metagame, specifically the lead department, was so huge it prompted the use of Lumberry leads with priority, namely Metagross and then later on Machamp. This was definitely not insignificant, as Metagross did not enjoy giving up the Akaberry that made it so hard to kill by the common Fire Blast, and thus speaks to how important Roserade was. Faster taunt leads like Aerodactyl and Azelf would also prevent it from laying Toxic Spikes down, but Roserade had access to the viciously powerful new move in Leaf Storm, and thus it wasn't completely helpless against them. Also, some players ran Choice Scarf to get the surprise early sleep off, which could be game-changing, and would then serve as a solid revenge killer, with defensive utility later. After a Sleep Powder, it could even use a free turn to lay down Toxic Spikes, as it'd likely be switching out anyway, and it'd also likely be meeting with Pokemon like Blissey, Zapdos, or Heatran that wouldn't mind switching into its attacks, so at least it still has this option against them. Speaking of Heatran, that was one of the slower leads, alongside Swampert, Hippowdon, and Bronzong that Roserade would absolutely feast on. Roserade would sometimes even take advantage of the fact that Heatran would stay in and choose to run Hidden Power Ground, effectively luring it. But of course, not all teams are affected by Toxic Spikes, much if at all, and Roserade has had the metagame shift to counter it significantly. But again, that speaks to how effective it was. Anyone who knows anything about DPP will immediately tell you that lead Roserade is one of the most definitive Pokemon in the tier, since being able to cripple Blissey and Tyranitar upon entry led to all sorts of special sweeping mayhem, and Roserade plus Swampert was a favorite combination for quick, synergistic hazards. But of course, Roserade was not only a great lead, since it could use its lead set outside the lead position, except instead of Focus Sash, it would choose to run Leftovers or Black Sludge. The latter was especially effective, given how good Roserade is at switching into Rotom appliances who are trying to use Trick. Running Roserade mid-game let it pick its spots a bit more, and also let it use its nice bulk in typing to check Pokemon like Suicune, Shaymin, and the aforementioned Rotom. However, during the Latias and Salamence era, some players took note of Roserade's excellent special defense stat that managed to tank hugely powerful Draco Meteors in spite of its meager HP, and thus began using a more defensive set to set up the more generally useful Spikes, which Roserade also had, but was illegal alongside Sleep Powder, and thus shunned as a lead set. But on a defensive set, it definitely shined. While it sometimes ran Stun Spore to spread some form of status, status and cripple big threats such as Heatran, Infernape, the Dragons, and Gengar, who it incidentally checked very well with investment and special defense. It could also use Rest alongside Natural Cure for excellent recovery. This would let it set up multiple layers in Blissey's face and heal its seismic tosses off. With HP Fire, it could destroy Fortress, and for many other entry points such as Rotom and Restock Gyarados, it was a classic stall team's nightmare, especially if it opted to go the double spiking route by using Toxic Spikes in the fourth slot. Even in the modern day, where the focus on spinning has shifted to Starmie, Roserade matches up well against it and thus retains the niche. Plus, in an ironic twist, it could soak up Toxic Spikes set up by opposing Roserade in the lead slot. And combined with its ability to handle dangerous special attackers, teams with defensive Roserade became infuriating for offensive Roserade teams. This defensive spike set made a beautiful pairing with Stealth Rock Heatran, and thus was the foundation of the powerful spike stacking offensive teams that fueled beasts such as Lucario and were hugely popular in the post-Latias and Salamence era. Overall, Roserade was a hugely defining Pokemon in many ways in the Diamond Pearl Platinum era, and a terrific part of the metagame. Now on to Black and White. Roserade had the toughest competition possible in the new generation, since there was a new grass-type spiker that came to the forefront. Ferrothorn, who packed much better bulk and a steel typing, which was also crucial in the land of Latios and Stealth Rock. However, it did have some unique tools, and while it could never come close to becoming a metagame staple, it did see itself on a solid number of teams due to the roles that it filled that Ferrothorn couldn't. First off, with the brutal new sleep mechanics, Sleep Powder was essentially a KO. Second, setting and absorbing Toxic Spikes was still incredibly key, since so many of the metagame's key Pokemon, including all the weather setters, did not enjoy getting toxic, like Terrakion, Jellicent, Mew, and Garchomp. Finally, it had Natural Cure to shrug off burns from Rotom Wash's Will-O-Wisp, and it could also shrug off burns from the ever-present Scald, which was also hugely valuable, and a big reason why specially defensive Celebi became so prominent later in the generation. The buffed Giga Drain meant Roserade could also gain some health back while staying on the offensive, but of course it was still comparatively niche. But it found places on quite a few of Black and White's most successful teams. However, it firmly dropped to underuse, where there it was excellent, opting for more offensive Life Orb sets as it would enter on one of the many, many water types in the tier, shut something down with Sleep Powder, then begin throwing around incredibly powerful Sludge Bombs that the prominent fire types of underuse did not want to deal with, and even the ridiculously bulky Snorlax was scared of the follow-up Leaf Storm. Roserade could also don its old defensive spike set in this tier for bulkier teams, offering defensive synergy while systematically softening the other team up, creating opportunities for its teammates to lock the opponent down into a position they couldn't recover from. And with all of this, Roserade was one of Underuse's best Pokemon, a definitive part of that metagame. And incidentally, the introduction of Eviolite meant Roselia was actually pretty okay as a defensive dual spiker in rarely use. With Alolamola everywhere to set up on, Roselia could set its teammates up well, crippling common Pokemon such as Drudigan with its hazards and checking dangerous threats such as Lilligant. Cryogonal spinning against it was a potential threat, but if it landed a poison from Sludge Bomb, it'd be a different dynamic. Plus, rarely use was not lacking in viable ghosts. Roselia was also viable in never used, but ironically, it was worse there than in the higher tier, thanks to the metagame not being as conducive to it, as there were less defensive waters and various grasses for it to take advantage of. Overuse was way beyond its reach now, with every new mega dumpstering it, so Roserade settled into underuse from the very beginning and made itself comfortable. It returned to its tricks of the previous generation. Its primary variant was once again Life Orb, although it was now much more inclined to run one kind of spikes, and it could also use Technician as opposed to Natural Cure to boost the now nerfed hidden power to an excellent base 90. The second variant was the specially defensive set, although with the prominence of Defog, having its only primary source of pressure come from spikes wasn't as good. The Life Orb variants had powerful attacks in addition to the spikes, whereas the defensive variants were mainly just spikers. Also, spikes was no longer illegal alongside Sleep Powder now. Roserade's ferocious Sludge Bombs feasted on the new fairy types, and while it wasn't as prominent as in the previous generations, thanks to new threats such as Infernape and Entei, and its low physical defense being exploited by Crocodile's Pursuit, Roserade remained a fine member of the underused tier, capable of slotting itself on a good number of teams and performing at least decently game in and game out. And as for VGC, Roserade appeared a few times in 2014, but overall, it was overshadowed by the likes of Amoongus and Mega Venusaur and completely destroyed by most Pokemon in the metagame, thus not letting it do much of anything, and the only reason you'd realistically use Roserade is if you really wanted to use one. That said, let's look at placements. Hajime Uesugi placed 7 with it at the Salem Regionals, while Henry M also used it and reached the finals of the Senior Division. Eric Herrera placed 15 at the St. Charles Regionals, and someone named Patrick placed 12th with it at the Auckland Regionals. Though unfortunately, we could not find the sets of any of these Roserades, so we're unsure of what these things actually did. Now on to Sun and Moon. Again, OU was a pipe dream by now, and even Underused was getting to be too difficult for it to keep up with. But Roserade found a new tier where its attributes fit it perfectly. Rarely used. There, it was able to pull its old tricks off with aplomb, alongside with some new ones, all the while taking advantage of the dangerous Milotic. While the prominence of both itself and Drapion meant Toxic Spikes were not as useful, regular Spikes are always good, and the classic Life Orb set was as good as ever. It could even swap out that Life Orb for Poisonium Z and have a nasty acid downpour to bypass and destroy the bulletproof Pokemon like Komo-o and Chestnut while absolutely hammering the common Mandibuzz. Grassium Z enabling Bloom Doom could destroy specially defensive Gligar, and in general have an attack so powerful it was likely to crush anything that wasn't named Dragalge. Choice Scarf sets emerged in popularity thanks to their ability to check Dragon Dance for Alligator, as well as outspeeding other prominent Pokemon such as Zygarde 10%, Drapion, and Salazzle. And on switches to walls, it could use spikes and make progress, as opposed to most Choice Scarfers, which can be dead weight against more defensive teams. Overall, Roserade is one of the best, most definitive Pokemon, and Sun and Moon rarely used. And that's it, so how good were Roselia and Roserade actually? Well, the pre-evolution wasn't great, with the exception of its surprisingly solid Eviolite antics in Black and White rarely used. However, Roserade was great. It was one of the most important Gen 4 Pokemon in a variety of roles that helped shape the metagame in numerous ways. In Black and White, it was less usable on a wide variety of teams, but it was unique and effective enough to find a place on several of the most successful teams in the generation, and in Underused, it was absolutely excellent. Though in the following generations, it wasn't as good, but it was still a fine choice, and Sun and Moon saw it go a tier lower and become diversely dominant, at least in that tier. But in VGC, it was sadly outclassed by the incredible competition it faced as a grass type, and was too frail to keep up with the incredible Pokemon that were added year after year. However, overall, Roserade is pretty good. It slipped throughout the years, but fundamentally, it was one of the most solid grass types out there. Thanks for watching, everyone, and as always, if you liked the video and you want to see more, be sure to subscribe to False White Gaming for more weekly Pokemon content, and of course, as I always say, comment on what Pokemon you want to see next. Also, thank you so much to our patrons for continued support of our videos, and thank you to everyone else watching as well. And follow my crew on these social media platforms, and that's all I got. See you next time, everyone.